Hello, RGL 2100 students. Dr. Conway here, back for lesson 8, which is a short lesson coming back from our break, but building on lesson 7, which was the information intensity of the regulatory process, which was a longer lecture. But now I want to situate the issue of information into more of a theoretical envelope by looking at the implications of information for the distribution of power in the regulatory process between public actors and public goods and private actors and the private interest. This will be some key short points that we'll go through, and then we'll conclude for the information segment of the course. All right, so let's get started on that short lesson this week. All right. So let's talk about information asymmetries and its effects on regulation. No organization, as we know, including regulators, right, even though regulatory organizations need to reveal a high level of expertise and a high level of competence and information quality to maintain public legitimacy and therefore high levels of voluntary compliance, no organization has perfect information, right? In fact, much of the activity of any organization is gathering, assimilating, and adjusting to new information. So a lot of regulatory affairs jobs are essentially about gathering and analyzing information within their spheres of regulatory influence, all right? But, you know, regardless of that, it's very rare that any regulator within a government organization will ever know as much about a company or a sector that's being regulated than the sector itself, right? So there's always bound to be problems of information asymmetries between regulators and firms. And this has a significant implication for the regulatory process, all right? We don't have to get into the fancy terminology of information asymmetry, but to understand the key points, and I just want you to understand them at the level that I'm presenting them. So there's a whole bunch of other subcategories of issues like moral hazard and so on and so forth that we don't need to spend a lot of time on here to get the main points that I'm trying to make, okay? Information asymmetry is an imbalance between two negotiating parties in their knowledge of the relevant factors and details. All right, so what would be an example of that in the real world? So you're going in to buy a used car, right? That used car salesman has a lot more information about that car than you coming into the lot, looking at it, and deciding whether or not to buy it. And that's it. That's a clear example of an imbalance of power in negotiation between the seller and the buyer in that situation. All right. And obviously, we've all experienced those situations where you're not sure that something is worth what the person is asking for it, and you ask them, and of course, they'll tell you that the product is worth more than they're selling it for. You're getting a good deal, right? As a buyer, you're sitting there suspiciously thinking, well, I don't have enough information to make this call. It puts you in a much more difficult negotiating position relative to the person that has more information available to them, right? And that's why the industry, for example, the automobile industry has come under lots of pressure to introduce things like Carfax and things like that, right? To correct asymmetrical information. And much of what regulation is about is correcting asymmetrical information problems. So a lot of regulations will involve not only having to comply with various performance standards or technical standards, but they'll also have informational reporting requirements to make sure that there's some correction brought to asymmetrical information about, for example, how chemicals are being managed in industry. Industry not only has to comply with the performance standards, which may be air or water or land performance standards to keep contamination under certain levels, they're also required to report what they're doing with the chemicals, how they're disposing them, whether they're transferring them off-site, and so on and so forth, right? And the reason that those information requirements are built into the regulation is to balance the problem of asymmetrical information, all right? Because information is a key component of power in the state, and it goes a long way to influencing regulatory design, implementation, and performance reviews, right? When regulators are at an information disadvantage, administrative decision costs increase substantially, right? Because more time and resources have to be expended to be able to target the regulatory design properly, right? Because right now we don't have enough information, so we have to gather more. It's costly, right? Initiating and designing new regulations is constrained due to uncertainty. You know, regulators can be put into a position of great deal of uncertainty as to how to react on a problem, even if they have strong inclinations that this is the these are the factors of harm. They're not 100% sure because their information is not comprehensive. Most governments and most bureaucratic systems will be largely risk averse in those situations, which can have a negative downward pressure on public goods, which regulations are, right? The tendency not to do it yet. Let's not do it yet until we know more. Let's not do it yet until we know more, all right? And then regulatory enforcement is hampered by requirements to satisfy evidentiary or burden of proof requirements, right? So information becomes very important there as well. And there's a reluctance sometimes to go to full enforcement by regulators because they're not confident in the information that's been provided about how the situation has emerged, whether it was just an accident or whether it's a consistent failure to comply. And sometimes these information requirements can become quite intensive and it's difficult for the regulator to act with confidence, right? So it's a very important issue, right? And it has a very important impact on transaction costs. We all know what transaction costs are now, right? The transaction costs to bring something into effect, whether and information is a very important transaction cost. Typically, regulators with better information about regulated entities, that is, with lower information asymmetries, have lower decision costs or transaction costs, thereby facilitating regulatory policymaking. The transaction costs in convincing people to that the regulation is the right direction go way down when the quality of your information is good. They're way up, and you're battling in the media, you're battling other apprehensions because your information is not comprehensive or convincing enough, right? So your decision costs and your transaction costs go through the roof, and those can be very, very expensive, all right? So when we move out of the idealized world of perfect information into the real world, the choice of regulatory options becomes a significant challenge when transaction costs are raised because information quality is uncertain, okay? And this has very real implications on moving forward, right? Like on various ways of regulating genetic engineering or nanoparticles or whatever. You know, why is the we know that nanoparticles can create issues, but the government isn't regulating aggressively in that area because the knowledge infrastructure is not there yet to know how to target harm reduction in those areas, all right? Information gaps can bias regulatory choice towards regulatory options that might be unusual or are usual or suboptimal, right? Like, we don't know enough, but we've always done it this way, so let's do it this way, when that might not be the most optimum way to get at the factors of harm, right? And so you end up with a suboptimal choice because you're relying on what you've always done rather than what relying on what the new information should tell you you should be doing. And that's happened a lot in regulation through various jurisdictions around the world, right? Where we rely on the typical choices because we're not 100% sure how to improve from a suboptimal choice to a more optimal choice because our information is not adequate. So the cost can be very extensive associated with these problems of information asymmetry, all right? And that's, like I say, that's why regulatory organizations spend a lot of time designing regulations that also have information requirements built into them, but also doing their own scanning of information on an ongoing basis. A lot of young regulatory people in government are hired primarily just to collect, to monitor, to input data sets on information so that regulatory decisions are made from a perspective of more balanced information, all right? So all of these things with why information is power is that the lack of information is power on the other side, and that can put a downward pressure, right, on public goods, all right? I mean, there's a tendency to avoid risk. There's a tendency to rely on the same old, same old. There's a tendency to not act at all because we don't know enough, right? So information is more than just requirements that you have to do to go through a regulatory development process like in Lesson 7. 7. Information has very significant power dimensions within regulation and the provision of public goods, right? The natural human bias to go slow or forego action altogether is there when you don't have adequate information gathering mechanisms, right? And this can have a significant impact on the provision of public goods and the public legitimacy of government and regulators within the state. Because if regulated parties can pick at errors in the information of the government or an unconvincing argument for why harm must be reduced in this area. For example, we're seeing a bit of that now with single-use plastics. We're also seeing that, you know, in the case of climate change mitigation and the use of the carbon tax. People, you know, when the information is not convincing, is not publicly revealed in a convincing manner, power relationships change. It becomes easier to criticize the regulator. The regulator then becomes more apprehensive about action, goes slower, or takes more conservative approaches than what the optimum outcome should be, all right? And information costs can be substantial in terms of political capital as well. Law changes, legal proceedings, money, staff, skill, and time, right? Information costs become a very significant issue if you have to generate them, you know, suddenly or rapidly, or there's a major problem. You haven't been generating them as you've gone along. You haven't been capturing them. You haven't been analyzing data properly as you go along. The implications for the regulator can be very significant. And information costs, typically in any regulatory environment, are the lion's share of implementation costs, not to mention the lion's share of design costs. Information requirements are an absolute critical ingredient for any regulator, okay, in any regulatory process, okay? And one prominent strategy for addressing imperfect information and information asymmetries in regulation design has involved reversing the burden of proof between the regulator and the regulated. You know, in past systems, a company would propose a regulation for market access, and the government would have to prove it was unsafe, right? And we still have much of that same system in Canada. Whereas, for example, in the REACH system in the European Union, why REACH was so controversial, is because it reversed the burden of proof. Now the chemical advocate needs to be able to demonstrate, they have to demonstrate that their product is safe against criteria provided by the state. All right, so the costs then shift to the regulated party. The responsibility to prove safety and efficacy moves to the regulated party rather than moving to the state, all right, to validate, right? So now, you know, all of that becomes a reversal of burden of proof, which now means that that party needs to provide the state with all the required information, right? Rather than the party, providing the state with minimal information and then the government conducting its own studies. Now, you know, the all of the information must be provided by the chemical advocate to the state. And that substantially deals with this whole question. And this was what was controversial about REACH. This is 90% of it, right? Was the reversal of the burden of proof to address the problem of asymmetrical information. The politics around REACH was politics of asymmetrical information and desire to bring correction to that, all right? So reversing the burden of proof, governments substantially strengthen the quality of their information and reduce the asymmetries in information that almost always contribute to power imbalances between the regulator and the regulated party, all right? So if you're really serious about protecting public health, the assumption becomes one of, you're proposing a chemical, you prove it's safe and efficacious, all right? And we'll evaluate your studies rather than having to do a lot of our own, all right? And that then becomes a much more level playing field than discussing things like alternatives or redesign or whatever the case may be. And this is why the chemical industry fought so extensively. The international, multinational chemical industry fought so extensively against REACH. It was one of the most contentious political issues in Europe for almost a decade as the industry lobbied against this component of a reversal of burden of proof. And for the reasons why they did that, because information is power in the regulatory process, okay? On that score, I'll let you go for this week, and we'll be back to you soon, okay? Take care now, bye-bye.